Well, good morning. It's good to see you guys. Good morning. Yeah, we have a huge special guest. I mean, he's not huge, but it's a blessing to have, I would say pastor, but Bob Parucha, who's an amazing man. He'll be sharing today, and I'm excited for that. So, but before we get to that, I do want to say welcome to all of you who are perhaps here for the first time, or you may not know me. My name is Dan. If you have been coming for a couple weeks, I haven't been here. In doing the announcements, which a lot of people are like, man, Dan's back, bummer, but that's okay. I'm going to make you suffer through some of these announcements this morning. The first one is that immediately after Sunday school, we are going to have our potluck today, so please make a note of that. If you did not bring anything, we still encourage you to come. It's our fellowship meal and just hanging out with everybody. I know they're amazing food, and if you have any questions on that, please contact the Valdeers for that. Also, immediately following the potluck, which you don't have on the slide there, is that we're going to be having the hymn sing. So if you want to stay and just make a day of it, please do so and contact Diana right there for the hymn sing. On Tuesday the 7th, we are continuing our men's fellowship, and that's going to be here at the church at 6:30 to 7:30 in the sanctuary. And this is a weekly study that's facilitated and led by Bill Johnson. If you have any questions, please contact him. The theme of it is Christian masculinity and surgery of the heart. The doors open for coffee and bagels at 6 a.m. And because I'm such a morning person, I'm there. It's not funny. On the 10th, which is a Friday night, we're going to continue our Financial Peace University. It continues from 6 to 7 here at Branch. It's going to be 9 weeks left. If you did not attend the first meeting, that's okay. We'd still love to have you on the second meeting. It's Dave Ramsey's program for getting out of debt and managing your money. It's a really good program. I know a lot of us here at church have been through it. If you have any questions on that?
It starts at 7.
Okay, well, it starts at 7. Just so you guys know, that's wrong. But you can come here at 6 and wait outside for an hour if you feel like it. No one's saying you can't, okay? But yes, it's going to be at 7 o'clock. Contact the Trimpers for the right details. On the 11th, which is the Saturday coming up, we're going to have our chili cook-off, and that's going to be here at 5:30. Hopefully that time is correct. At Branch, it's a chili cook-off, and I'm really excited about this. In addition to chili, we need people to bring cornbread and chili toppings. Sign up in the foyer today. You can contact Seth. You can just contact Seth Kennard back there. He just raised his hand. He's going to be heading that up. Would love to have you guys involved in that. Who doesn't like chili, especially when it's cold? And then on March 11th, we're going to be announcing that there's a men's gathering at Scholb Brewery. And this is going to be at 12:30 p.m. And you're going to join the men at the church as they fellowship together. It's a very casual event. Anybody's welcome to come. Men of all ages, so bring the little men too if you have them. We'll introduce them to Scholl Brewery. No, we won't. Snacks will be provided, but RSVP please to Jacob Trimper for that. And then please check Church Center for the church calendar if you want more information on anything that we're doing. We have stuff on the website as well. So with that, we will begin.
Good morning. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 52, verses 8 and 9. And these two verses talk about, here the psalmist is talking about the blessedness of God's people, those who trust in him, those who take refuge in him, in contrast to who he calls the wicked, the evildoers, who, as he says, take refuge in their own destruction. So Psalm 52, verses 8 and 9, before I read it, why don't we take a moment to prepare our hearts for worship. But I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. I trust in the steadfast love of God forever and ever. I will thank you forever because you have done it. I will wait for your name, for it is good in the presence of the godly. Thus far, the reading of God's holy and inspired word. Let us pray. Almighty God and Father in heaven, we have heard your call and we enter into your gates with thanksgiving, in your courts with praise. For you are the true and living God, beside whom there is none other. You alone created all things by the word of your power. You commanded, let there be, and there was everything that we see around us. And you alone are sovereign, infinite in your holiness and justice, the righteous judge who will by no means acquit the guilty and will repay the wicked according to their ways. But with your people, you are the covenant-making, covenant-keeping God, whose steadfast love endures forever and whose faithfulness extends throughout all generations. We thank you that despite the mess that humanity has made of your creation, despite all of our sin, our rebellion, and corruption, you did not abandon your people, but loved us with an everlasting love, and you saved us from the wrath to come. For you sent your own beloved Son to be the light in our darkness, the healing hand that binds up our brokenness, the Lord Jesus Christ, who perfectly obeyed your will unto death, even the cursed death of the cross, where he laid down his life as a ransom for many. Truly, Father, what can we say or do in response to so great a salvation except to fall on our faces and give you all praise, all glory, and honor and thanksgiving? Yet, Father, we are so quick to forget the benefits of our salvation, so quick to act and think and speak in ways that do not honor you, so quick to stray from your commandments. So during this time of silent and private confession of sin, we pray that you would bring to our minds those many things that grieve your Holy Spirit within us and hear our plea for forgiveness. We thank you, Father, that you are faithful and just to forgive us because of the perfect work of your Son, whose blood cleanses us from all unrighteousness and who covers us with his perfect obedience. As we continue our worship, we do pray that your Spirit would guide, direct, and empower us so that our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving would be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ and for his sake. Amen. The Apostle John, in chapter 2 of his epistle, says this: "My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. So, brothers and sisters, if you indeed believe that Jesus Christ is your advocate before the throne of God, that he's fully satisfied for all of your sins, if you are trusting in Christ alone for salvation, then I declare to you what the scriptures declare, that your sins have been washed away."
Tell your love and all your faithfulness by night with time. Good morning, saints. This is the time in our service when we recite the congressional. Okay. Congregational reading. I should read it in Congress. So I will read the question. Now I'm all flustered. And you can read the answer. Thank you. But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him and saying, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Please pray with me. Almighty and ever-living God, our Father, please hear our prayer as we come to you in the name of the Son and in the power of the Spirit. Help us, O Lord, the deacons of this church, to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength as we fulfill the duties, our duties, and oversee the administration of these tithes and offerings. Likewise, help us, O Lord, to obey your commandment to love our neighbors, especially our brethren whom you love and have effectually called to life in Christ and made members of this church. May our service be a blessing to those in need, and always glorify Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Just a reminder that the elders are available for prayer after the service, should you have any need. So this is now the time of our corporate prayer where we bring our petitions before the Lord. So please join me in prayer. Father God, we approach your throne of grace now to find help in our time of need. And we come in the name of your Son, Jesus, our High Priest, who intercedes for us, and by the support and comfort of your Holy Spirit, who knows the thoughts of your mind and gives us the mind of Christ that we might understand the things that you have freely given us. We first give you thanks and praise for your kindness and goodness toward us, for we often forget the things that we enjoy by your providence. Truly, you are the Lord who provides our daily bread, who nourishes us with food and drink, and clothes and shelters us. You are the merciful God who protects his children. We thank you for watching over Mia Claus and her daughters this week, that they were not seriously hurt as a result of a bad car accident. We thank you for the bystanders and the firemen that helped them get clear of the vehicle. And we ask for continued healing, both of body and mind. We thank you also for the Bonds family, that Peter is back full-time with Stacy and Tyler. We do continue to pray for a full closure to this case so they can put this whole episode behind them. Father, we also pray for Allie Long, who is due this month, asking for a safe delivery and a healthy baby. Children indeed are a gift from the Lord, and we thank you for our children of all ages within this covenant family. We pray that their faith would grow, that their knowledge of your word would increase, that they would not be led astray by the temptations of this world, empty promises of love and fulfillment that only lead to death. We pray rather that by the power of the Holy Spirit they would embrace and cling to Christ, our Savior and Lord, who truly loves us and gave himself for us. Pray for ourselves as parents that we would model Christ for them, that you would give us wisdom and patience to teach and correct, to minister and to labor for them. Father, we do pray now for the many health needs and concerns affecting members of this church and their loved ones. Continue to pray for Gwen, Debbie's mother, that her vision would return. For our sister, Bonnie Coronado, who had her hernia surgery rescheduled, we ask that you would keep her from being anxious, that her surgery would be successful. For Jen Meyer, who suffers from pain and many issues that keep her not only from coming to church, but from doing many things that most of us are accustomed to doing. And for Irene Thompson, who has been and continues to suffer from severe back pain, we pray that you would bring healing and relief to these dear sisters. We continue to ask for your protection and peace upon those suffering from dementia and Alzheimer's, and the daily difficulties that they experience. Father, how easy it is for them and their families to be discouraged and to feel worn down by the weight of suffering, of being worried, of facing constant challenges and major decisions. Father, we ask that you would grant them an extra measure of strength and wisdom to help them endure these difficulties. We pray the same for those battling cancer. For Julie Herzl, we pray that her treatments would be effective and that she would experience relief from pain. Pray for Jeannie Alessandrini and her procedure this Wednesday, asking that it would be effective in removing the cancer and that she would experience complete healing. Pray also for Karen Gregg, Mike and Michelle's sister-in-law, dealing with a third recurrence of brain cancer, asking for your comfort upon her and her family during this difficult time. We also think of Debbie, Carrie Booth's mother, battling lung cancer, for Andrea Lucero, for Rex Monson, and Mike Heon's niece, Jeannie, asking that in each case you would bring healing, comfort, and encouragement. We do continue to pray, Father, for our missionaries and the spreading of the gospel throughout the world. We pray for Mike and Lily McCabe laboring in China, asking that their ministry would bear fruit. And we continue to pray for Pastor Pan and the families with him in Thailand, that you would be merciful, that you would grant them favor with the Thai authorities, so that their petition for refugee status would be successful. In the meantime, Father, would you sustain and encourage these dear brothers and sisters and give them strength to endure this time. Father, there are so many other unspoken concerns and requests, other health issues, financial and employment difficulties, strained and even broken relationships between spouses and family members, struggles with depression and other conditions affecting the mind. But you, Father, know everything that we're going through, and we thank you that you hear us. Help us to not be anxious, but to seek first your kingdom and righteousness, and trust that you will provide what we need according to your perfect will. Now, as we turn our attention to your word, we pray that your spirit would open our ears and plant your word in our hearts so that it might bear fruit for your glory. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Receive the food of your holy word.
think so. All right. Good to see everybody here. This is my third time up here, and I always it's always humbling and an honor to be here, especially when you think of Pastor Paul laboring every week to give us the word. So thank you for your prayers as we open up God's word today. Today's verse is Philippians 3:12 through 14. Now hear the word of the Lord. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for this day, this Sabbath day you've given us of rest and worship to honor you and your Son. We pray that your Spirit would be present, dwelling in us, Father, and illuminating our hearts and minds, opening our hearts to your word. May this the word be planted in our hearts firmly and grow like a wonderful, beautiful olive tree that your psalmist talks about, Father. Thank you for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I have had these verses pinned up on a corkboard in my office for several years, and this passage is one of those go-to sections of Scripture that I've looked to for inspiration and comfort during difficult times. It's a consolation to know that looking over my shoulder at past sins and failures would not help me run the race set before me. That brooding over them was actually a hindrance. Not that I did not regret my past transgressions, but that dwelling on them and brooding on them was going to actually obstruct me from knowing Christ more fully. It's also uplifting and encouraging to trust that God has mercifully and gracefully called us upwards. That no matter what our circumstances may be, there's a trajectory, there's a meaning, there's a focus, a direction that God has laid out for believers. Though the road ahead is fraught with potholes and detours, by God's grace, we press on toward growth, maturity, and sanctification. And based on his promises, we know there is an amazing end to this race we call life. Now, on the flip side, these verses challenge us to exert maximum effort in the Christian life, to be single-focused, to be determined, to be active, to be intentional, and this is a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week enterprise. That's a lofty goal. My question to myself is, am I lengthening my stride in this race at all, or am I just on cruise control? Had I gotten to a point where things were good enough and I could take my foot off the pedal and just kind of coast for a bit, looking back at my justification and cruising into the kingdom? In this passage, the Apostle Paul exhorts us to think otherwise. These verses are both reassuring and yet a direct challenge to everyone to give more, serve more, and put others first continually. And in this process, we call sanctification to lay hold of more fully the person and work of Christ. So before we start to unpack these verses together, I'd like to back up a little bit and briefly reflect on who is it that is speaking in Scripture. Now, I know we have a lot of really intelligent people in this church, and this may seem like Christianity 101 for most, but I find that when I open up Scripture and forget who is actually speaking, it doesn't penetrate. I'll read, and I forget who it is that is speaking to us through His Word. I fail to give Scripture the weight and attention that it demands. The thrice holy God of all creation, the only source of goodness, truth, and beauty, the Heavenly Father that has our lives in His hands. So let's take a look at briefly the basic attributes of God, and we could spend a lot of time on this, friends, but I'm just going to go over this briefly. First, God is omnipotent. Isaiah 43:13, even from eternity, I am He,
and there is none who can deliver out of my hand. I act, and who can reverse it? God is the all-powerful creator and sustainer of the universe. He spoke the universe into being, ex nihilo, out of nothing. God is omnipresent, Jeremiah 23:24. Am I a God who is near, declares the Lord, and not a God far off? Can a man hide himself in hiding places so I do not see him, declares the Lord? Do I not fill the heavens and the earth, declares the Lord? God is everywhere, all at once. Inconceivable. There is no place in the far-flung universe where God cannot and does not work. God is omniscient, Hebrews 4:13. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are open and laid bare to the eyes of him with whom we have to do. God knows all and sees all from beginning to end. He has X-ray vision into our hearts. That's a scary thought. The Westminster Shorter Catechism states that God is a spirit, infinite, eternal, and unchangeable in his being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth. That pretty much says everything. God is both transcendent, and yet he's personal. He knows us intimately. He preserves and sustains each one of us moment to moment. Right now, he is holding the world together in this moment. The psalmist says, my times are in thy hand. Francis Schaeffer comments, he's a personal God in true history that goes on forever. Jeremiah 1:5 states, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Now, this is the true and living God that speaks to us in his word. So now that we've taken a very quick overview of God, let's look at God's chosen vessel to the apostle, to the Gentiles, the apostle Paul. Well, he only wrote 13 letters in the New Testament. He was a missionary, a trailblazer, a pastor, an evangelist, a theologian, and a teacher. He was a towering intellect, but not only that, he had a tender heart. He had a deep affection for believers and he took great joy in seeing God work in their hearts and their lives. Philippians 1:8 states, for as God is my witness, how I yearn for you all with the affection of Christ Jesus. Now, I'm not going to pronounce the Greek word here because I'll butcher it, but the Greek word translated here as affection is the word for intestines, spleen, guts, our inner being. It connotes that deep feeling for someone that emanates from the pit of our stomachs. This describes the love that Paul had for the Philippians, a love that flowed from the depths of his being. Paul's heart was continually being enlarged with the compassion of Christ. So, keeping the greatness and majesty of God and the lofty example of the Apostle Paul, let's now look at the Epistle to the Philippians. This letter is personal. It's a personal thank you note, friendship letter from Paul to the church at Philippi, which Paul and his colleagues had established in Acts. It's recorded in Acts 16:10. The church at Philippi had a special place in Paul's heart. The Philippians had come to Paul's side with financial and moral support, and for this, he expresses his heartfelt gratitude. His circumstances are challenging, to say the least. He's in prison, chained to a Praetorian guard day and night for 2 years. Awaiting his trial before Caesar, he doesn't know whether he will live or he'll die. This must have been frustrating, since Paul is the ultimate AA personality, type A personality, always on the go, striving for the sake of the gospel and the cause of Christ. He's cut off from travel, freedom, family, friends, and fellowship. People are slandering him in town. He's the object of verbal attacks from fellow Christians. There are divisions in the church of Philippi that are threatening to tear up the church, so the situation is not conducive to joy for the Apostle Paul. Paul has every reason not to persevere, not to be joyful, but what's his response? Philippians 4:4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say again, rejoice. He's determined to rejoice no matter what the circumstances surrounding him are. His joy is constant, and he works at it. He strives for it. He perseveres through his difficult situation and commands the church at Philippi to follow his lead. The source of his joy is the Holy Spirit and his deepening knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. So for context of these verses we're unpacking, let's look at Philippians 3, 8 through 12, where Paul makes his case about what his ultimate aim is. He has laser focus on his target, Jesus. Philippians 3, 8 through 12. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith. So Paul's aim is really clear here. Knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Paul knew Jesus, but not completely. He desired more intimate acquaintance with him to have reproduced in him the life of his Lord Jesus. Now, Charles Spurgeon comments on this verse. Be sure of this, that the less you value your own righteousness, the more you will seek after true holiness. Now to our text. So Paul continues in verse 12. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect. So here's our first point. And if we take away anything today, I'd like us to take this away with us. No one has arrived. No one has arrived at fully knowing Christ or has attained full Christ-likeness. Perfection and ultimate spiritual maturity lie out of his and our reach. Spiritual perfection, full knowledge of Christ is impossible because there is so much more that lies ahead of us to reach the goal of Christ's likeness, and Christ is infinite in his compassion. Whether we have just entered the race or been in the race for decades, Paul's message is the same. We cannot slow down. Now, the Pharisees seem to believe that perfection was possible by the external observance of the law, but they had a superficial understanding of God's true demands. As Jesus said, Matthew 23, 25 to 26, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you clean the outside of the cup and the plate, but the inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisees, first clean the inside of the cup and the plate, that the outside may also be clean. So, could they, or anyone who has ever lived, say they had perfectly loved God every moment of their lives with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength? Can any of us say that? Anyone who claims spiritual perfection suffers a deluded, elevated view of their own performance, something that we as fallen creatures do quite naturally. So the misunderstanding, the lowering or dilution of God's moral standard, the law, and the elevation of one's own spiritual performance in one's own eyes results in the erroneous conclusion that we can arrive at spiritual perfection. There's an unbridgeable chasm between fallen creature and God, and this narrows when we bring God's law down and we elevate ourselves. Proverbs 21:2 states, the ways of a man are right in his own eyes, but God weighs the hearts. Paul recognized his need of divine grace as God's supernatural enabling power to live for Christ. The longer the apostle ran the race, the lower was his view of himself, and the more exalted was his view of Christ. 1 Timothy 1:15 states, the saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. Well, this is the most convicting part of the passage. If the greatest Christian ever to walk the face of the earth has not arrived, what about us? The race is still on. We can't slow down. Finishing the race will require maximum effort and sanctification as we pursue holiness. This realization is critical for all of us as Christians. None of us have arrived at full Christ-likeness. So John Calvin puts it this way. Paul adds that he has not as yet arrived at this. At what? At the attainment of having entire fellowship in Christ's sufferings, having a full taste of the power of his resurrection, and knowing him perfectly. He teaches, therefore, by his own example, that we ought to make progress, and that the knowledge of Christ is an attainment of such difficulty that even those who apply themselves to it do nevertheless not attain perfection in it, so long as they live. So here's our second point. Press on. Verse 13, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Well, now the Apostle Paul, and I love this, he makes several athletic references in his epistles. He exhorts us to take an aggressive and energetic mindset toward the goal of Christ's likeness, to push ourselves to the limit spiritually, and there is no passivity here. Even though Paul will never arrive at full Christ-likeness, he presses on to make it his own, as Christ Jesus has made Paul his own. There's no looking back at his own justification and writing that all the way into the kingdom. Paul wants us to be all in for the Christian life. Antinomianism is refuted in these verses. Jesus is both Savior and Lord. Colossians 1:29 states, "For this I toil, struggling with all his energy that he powerfully works within me." There's hard labor, there's toil and exertion in the Christian life, in knowing Christ more and being sanctified. Paul, in his life, he leaves it all on the field. So let's look at Paul's first encounter with Jesus, who apprehended Paul on the road to Damascus. Jesus, he just shut Paul down. He blinded him. He subpoenaed him. Jesus aggressively wrestled Paul into the kingdom, overpowering him. Acts 9, 1 through 8. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters from him to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found any who were of the way, whether men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven. Then he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" Then the Lord said, "I am Jesus, who you are persecuting. It is hard for you to kick against the goads." So he, trembling and astonished, said, "Lord, what do you want me to do?" The Lord said to him, "Arise and go into the city, and you'll be told what you must do." And the men who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice but seeing no one. Then Saul arose from the ground, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no one. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus, and he was there 3 days without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Now, nothing else could explain Paul's transformation from a wicked persecutor of Christians to the greatest Christian that ever lived, except for the supernatural call and this event. Because Christ laid hold of Paul, Paul pressed on to lay hold of Christ. Notice the order. Christ lays hold of us before we can even seek to make him our own. God is always ahead of us. God is always the initiator. Therefore, we are called to press on. Well, how are we to press on? Let's look at Philippians 2:12-13. "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure." God's grace enables us to press on, as it is God who works in us in the very depths of our being. God is working in us both to will and to work. Whatever we do as believers, God is always working in us. Now, this is a serious enterprise, working out our own salvation with fear and trembling, building on what God has initiated and is actively carrying out in us. Our responsibility in this working out of our salvation is pressing forward, leaning into our sanctification. So what's God's purpose in all of this? Well, it glorifies himself when he sees believers being sanctified, made more and more in his son's image. This pleases God. We press on through Bible study, through worship, through prayer, supplication, repentance, service, fellowship, evangelism, and the Lord's Supper, the means of grace. So point number three, straining forward. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. Now, Paul reconfirms that he has not laid hold of, apprehended, or made Christ completely his own. He reiterates and reinforces what he just said, that he has not arrived. He repeats this point to drive it home. None of us have arrived or will arrive until we're called home. But one thing he does. Paul is not double-minded or scattered in his life aim. Paul is single-minded in his focus of attaining Christ-likeness. He has blinders on. His attention is narrowly focused on the goal of knowing Christ more intimately. He is, as they would say, locked in. He led his Christian life looking straight ahead. In fact, Paul was so dynamic and prolific and useful in his ministry because of this intense focus on Christ and him crucified. Now, this doesn't mean that we're oblivious to things around us, but that there is one dominant vision and preoccupation that steers one's life. If you're running a race and you look behind you at the competitors or how far you've come, if you're distracted in any way, you'll trip. You'll be impeded. You will not win the race. So Paul, he doesn't focus on the past failures, sins, or successes. Paul had voluminous past sins. He repented and was forgiven, and God used him mightily. Once repented on and forgiven, the sins are cast away, as the Bible says, as far as the east is from the west. Paul had to let go of the past to finish the race. Paul suffered. He was persecuted. He was slandered. He had to let go of that as well. He had plenty of success in his evangelism and planting of churches. He had to let go of that. He couldn't look back. He has his eye on the prize. Yet, he simultaneously saw himself as the chief of sinners. How does that work? Well, a healthy remembrance of his sins kept him humble and thankful for the grace of Christ, the enablement to live the Christian life that God's grace provides. We come back to Spurgeon's comment and apply it here. Paul counted his own righteousness as rubbish, and in so doing, sought after true holiness. So, when we look back on the sins of our own lives, do we regret these transgressions, the people we've hurt with our words and our deeds, the offense to God? Yep. But we are in the race, and we cannot dwell on these. We cannot let these remembrances stop us or paralyze us from moving forward and continuing to progress in the Christian life. The description of the Christian life, straining forward, implies stretching to the breaking point, reaching forward, exerting intense energy to reach the goal, stretching spiritual muscles to the very limit, holding back nothing in our pursuit of Christ's likeness. Now, I don't know about you, this doesn't describe my life. I can always do better. I can lengthen my stride. It's a challenge. We can all lengthen our stride, exert a greater energy by the grace of God, utilizing all of the means of grace that have been provided. Again, I quote Charles Spurgeon. Does Paul not give the picture of a runner? The man, as he speeds, throws himself forward, almost out of the perpendicular. His eye is on the goal already. His hand is far advanced of his feet. His whole body is moving, leaning forward. He runs as though he would project himself to the end of the journey before his legs could carry him there. That is how the Christian should be, always throwing himself forward after something more than he has reached. Not satisfied with the rate at which he advances, his soul always going 20 times ahead of his flesh. Is that how we're running our race toward the prize of perfection in Christ? Finally, point number 4, the upward call. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. I love this, love that verse. Again, Paul is intentionally, aggressively pressing forward, leaning into the persecution and the resistance, actively pursuing the goal of Christ's likeness and sanctification and holy living. This is not let go and let God, friends, where we're waiting for God to produce some kind of feeling in us and stir us into action. That's not the point. Paul sees his life as a race. It's an athletic competition where he is earnestly following God's upward call in Christ. In 1 Corinthians, Paul exhorts his readers to run in such a way as to get the prize. 1 Corinthians 9:26 states, "So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air." Paul is intentional in his running. His life has a straight trajectory upwards. The author of Hebrews encourages us to run the race that is set before us. The Christian life is intensely active, pressing on toward the goal of the upward call. So, what is the goal? Well, Pastor Stephen Lawson states, "If you aim at nothing, you'll hit it every time." The goal is for us to know the person of Jesus Christ in a deeper and richer way, and in so doing, to become more like Christ. So what could be greater than to intimately know the God-man, our Lord and Savior? What could be greater? This is an upward call. It's glorifying for us to become, it's glorifying to God for us to become like His Son. The prize we're reaching for is not in this world, it's in the world to come. The prize of attaining the goal is given at the end of the race. The upper call is when God calls us home. This is on the mind of Paul, who is waiting his trial before Caesar. He doesn't know again whether he'll live or die. He's waiting and wanting the upward call, but he's willing to stay for the good of the church. This is the most glorious call that will ever come since Christ has removed the sting of death. The date is a promotion, a graduation to glory in Christ's presence. Now, for our final point, the way up is the way down. Excuse me, I got that wrong. The way down is the way up. Let me repeat that. The way down is the way up. The upward call is really the result of our downward walk as we humble ourselves to serve others. A Christian friend of mine years ago said that Christians were part of an upside-down kingdom. Before I was a believer, I was like, what's this all about? What the world held dear, we were to relinquish, and what the world saw as foolish, namely faith in Christ, we were to submit to. Christ was the ultimate example of true humility. Philippians 2:5 through 8 states this: "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. No one ever started out so high and descended so low as Christ did. His was the greatest display of humility. From the throne to Mount Calvary, he emptied himself by voluntarily relinquishing his God attributes, choosing not to exercise them in obedience to the Father. He came as a servant, descending into this world of sorrows. He was the ultimate man of sorrows, enduring the humiliation and degradation of death on a cross, reserved in that culture only for the worst of criminals. All true saving faith exhibits true humility." Again, I quote Stephen Lawson, "No one struts through the narrow gate. There are no peacocks in the kingdom of heaven, only sheep." We lower ourselves, coming to God with nothing in our hands. Every step in the Christian life is a step downward in humility that takes us into Christ-like humility. Humility means to think of or judge oneself with lowliness. If being Christ-like is our goal, our walk is a continual lowering of self to put others first. And in so doing, glorifying God through the process we call sanctification. Like the psalmist declares, we are firmly planted olive trees that will flourish in the house of God, bearing fruit. It is the work of the Holy Spirit in us that produces this type of humility, to have the best interest in the spiritual well-being of others. Jesus puts it simply, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. In the face of the world, the flesh, and the devil, may we continue to press on, press in, lean in, strive forward in our quest to become more like the God-man, Jesus the Christ, leaning on God's enabling grace to run the race set before us. And may the pull of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus draw us forward like an irresistible magnet, knowing that our Savior is standing at the finish line, waiting to receive us. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this, again, this time, this honor to unpack your word together with our fellow believers, Father. We just pray that you would continue to bless our efforts, that we would continue to strive, that we would continue to press on, that we would continue to lean into persecution and difficulties, Father, and know that there is truly an amazing prize at the end based on your promises, Father. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
His love.
Communion today, so I'll just close in prayer. Please pray with me. Father God, again, thank you for your mercy and your grace. Father, thank you for this congregation of believers. Father, thank you for believers all over the world. Father, we pray that you would continue to, as you promised, spread your gospel far and wide, that we may be salt and light this week in whoever we encounter, Father, that we may reflect your glory, that through us, Father. You would reflect your glory through us, Father. We just thank you. We pray for your blessing this week and your protection. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Yeah. Oh, okay. Hello, hello. Hello. We are live. We are live.
Hello out there in YouTube land.
Yes. Welcome to Q&A. Good to see everybody. Aaron Davies will manage this session. Full confidence.
No, you can't get out of it, Bob. You are answering the questions.
I will,
today.
But you're going to manage it. Yes.
I'm going to manage it.
You're
okay.
Going to protect me.
Oh, all right. Right? So be nice.
Yes. Yes. As Daniel laughs. All right.
So who would like to, in the room, ask a question for Mr. Parucha? We don't have any online, so.
Arnie.
Still.
No, you're not. You're.
Thanks for your exhortation. One yes, thing, sir. And it's possible I slept through your explanation of this because you did reference two passages that I want to compare and contrast, and it has to do with Philippians, I believe, was written. Of course, they're guesstimating on when it was, but somewhere probably around maybe 60 A.D. Roughly.
Based on
various reasons, mm-hmm. and maybe chronologically compared to other books and what was happening to Paul mm-hmm. at the time. And then Philippians, of course, was written probably one of the last books, possibly, in 65.
I know there were four prison epistles. I don't know the sequence.
My understanding is it was later, at least, right?
Okay.
But not, the question is, and I guess the thing I'm struggling with is, Philippians, the passage you were dealing with, that not only have I'm reading from a weird translation, but it's close enough. Not that I have already obtained this or been perfected, but I press on. And, the idea that he hasn't accomplished whatever his ultimate purpose is. Now, you discuss some of those things.
He has not arrived.
Right, right.
That's
but
Calvin
then it's weird
Spurgeon
that the
here's my...
in 2 Timothy, which was written... That's the one that was a lot later. That was apparently while he was the last imprisonment.
Okay.
And he says, hold on. Okay. That he finished the race. Mm-hmm. He's been perfected in some way. And I guess the thing is, that's where I missed it in your sermon, but it sounds like in 2 years or 3 years at most, he's moved from not completion to completion.
I would say not.
Okay.
Absolutely not.
Could you address
100%
that?
100% not. No one has ever arrived at sinless perfection. No one ever can. That was apparent from, I read Calvin, I read Spurgeon, the footnotes in my Bible. No one has ever attained spiritual perfection until God calls us home. Okay, but in this life, it's impossible. And yet the conundrum or the tension or the is the parallel truth is that we need to press on. God has commanded us to, because it glorifies him, to work in us his willing and doing, and we are to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. So continual work till the day you die, till the last breath, that's it. And there is no perfection on this planet.
I guess, then I'm wondering, what did he complete then? I mean,
he finished the race that was set before him, so he finished the race. God ordained every moment of his life and our lives.
True.
So he finished the race. He kept the faith. I mean, as imperfectly, but he did keep it in the sense that he was all in. Paul was all in. He kept it imperfectly, but he was still all in.
Right. I mean, I guess what bothers me is as we get older, we're getting closer to our demise way or another, right?
Uh-huh.
So, and I'm thinking even in his condition, he might have done his greatest work there. Who knows? Converted the emperor, right?
The Praetorian Guard and Caesar's household.
Or something, Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering if the reason he could be confident in saying that was because of a divine revelation he knew. Because it sounds weird that he would say he's complete, because I can't imagine anybody in this life saying, it's complete, unless they're 3 seconds from their last breath or something. You see my...
I do, and I think the only thing somehow, and I'm thinking through this as I'm speaking, so bear with me. If I know that I am leaving it all on the field, I can have peace with that. And yet, there's probably something else I could have done, and I know that, but I'm not going to look back at that. I'm going to continue to press forward because that's going to impede my progress in sanctification and knowing Christ fully. And it's not that I don't forget my sin like it's never happened. I regret it, but I'm not going to let that impede my sanctification process. Right? It's humbling. And in fact, what did Spurgeon say? More, you know, less of us and more of Christ, basically, is always a good thing. So the longer, as Pastor Paul would say, the longer the Apostle Paul got in his life, the lower he, in his own estimation, he became. Everything was rubbish, but Christ exalted him because of his humility. I don't know if that makes any sense. It's kind of upside down, isn't it? I mean, we talk about that. It's just, it's the world thinks that this is just, in fact, I read this, and Daniel, you'll have to back me up on this or correct me, okay? But in the word humility didn't even exist in Rome or Greek until about the third or fourth decade, fifth decade when Paul was around, because humility was an ignoble deal. It was about, you know, beating your chest and being strong and being dominant. That was what was valued in Roman and Greek culture. Humility was just like, are you kidding me? We don't even want to talk about this. So there's a thesis that Paul or one of his people invented the actual Greek word for humility, which means lowliness of mind about oneself. It's not beating yourself up, but in comparison to God and Jesus, it's not about our self-righteousness, it's about the righteousness of Christ. That makes sense? Yeah. Wait a minute. I answered your question? That's amazing. No, don't follow up.
I just think it's a hard question to really
It
answer.
Is, it is.
And
no,
I,
you're
I
right.
I put you in a hard spot.
No, you're,
confess,
no you, so, did, you didn't put me in a hard spot. I love your, and I love your, I love your, I love the questions. This is great. This is progress for me. Trust me. Yes.
Grandma, do you have a question?
Oh, yeah, Luann, yes.
Luann's first, yeah.
I decided to withdraw it because it caused confusion.
Right? Oh. You never know. We always love questions, especially from you.
Yeah.
Seriously. No, okay. Save it for Bible study then, Luann.
Yeah, I will.
So,
yes, sir.
In reference to Arnie, I think, to me, the way I understand 2 Timothy is that he really did feel like he was close to the end of his mm-hmm. ministry.
Yeah. Right.
You know, and so that's how I view all of mm-hmm. that. But, you know, he, of all people, you know, he was the one person that could say, I have kept the faith, I've finished the race. That was Paul. Mm-hmm. But my question is, I wanted to find out what you think about, you know, it is a great thing to look forward to that upward call, but do you think we in general and Americans that are Christians focus a lot on heaven and not on day-to-day life and building the kingdom of God and loving and serving him with our whole heart, soul, and mind and strength? I mean, it seems like we put a lot of emphasis on this upward call that, you know, Paul is talking about. I wanted to get your thoughts on that.
Well, I think the upward call can be interpreted in two ways. It's an upward call. It's like a magnet. God is drawing you upward. There's a trajectory to your life. There may be ups and downs and bumps, but there's a trajectory, an upward call that if we are called, God is going to finish the work that he started in us, number one. So that's an upward call. And then secondly, the upward call is toward the final upward call of the prize in Christ Jesus. And yeah, for sure. I mean, that's the prize. And I totally get your point about being, you know, heavenly minded all the time. But I mean, the first 6 or 7, you know, pages of the message were about the toil, the striving, the effort, running the race. In fact, Mick Herschel and I were talking about how, and I didn't know this, when somebody finishes a race, you know, the sprinters, it's the chest that crosses the line and not the foot. So that's kind of the Spurgeon's whole thing about leaning forward and being almost, parallel to the ground. You know, in our leaning forward, so that's all in this life, right? So that's striving, yeah. Straining, the athletics, gird up your loins, train yourself as a boxer. I mean, all those images, and the Bible is full of military images as well. The helmet of salvation, it's a battle, it's a fight. So, yes, we need to be focused on our current sanctification, lowering ourselves, serving others daily, you know, hour by hour. It's hard. It's, you know, it's a challenge. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't want to do it all the time. You know, I want to do what I want to do. So, but it's, you know, it's interesting. Anytime, you know, Aaron, I'm sure we'll share this as well, is that anytime we have something before us, okay, I got 6 weeks to prepare this. Okay, it's a long preparation, and it's actually very positive for us because we have to get into it. We have to dig in. I mean, I always like to have a goal, you know, like if it's a Bible study or a sermon or, you know, whatever, that helps me focus my mind on, because it's just the way I'm kind of goal-oriented, you know, what can I say? But it helps, so. Yes, Jerry, I'm sorry. You should be.
What are you sorry about? You're doing great.
Okay.
You're doing awesome.
You're handling that, but that's all right. Okay.
Good morning.
Yes, Jerry, go ahead.
Good morning. Thank you for your exhortation. Appreciate that. That was quite convicting. This is out of left field a little bit. You don't have to answer if...
Thank you.
If it's not appropriate.
Thank you for that courtesy. I won't answer if I don't want to.
Reserve the right to properly... But yesterday at the men's breakfast, someone made a comment that we frequently hear in our society regarding loving ourselves. Mm-hmm. And we obviously know that from Scripture we are commanded to love God. Mm-hmm. And actually, I believe he was a brother. I don't really know him that well.
Yeah.
But he mentioned that, you know, we are to love God and we are to love our fellow man. But he also elaborated on loving oneself. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to get your take on that, because
kind of picked up my ears a little bit. And I think maybe, who knows, I don't know what theological church he came from or what his background is, or if he's a new believer, if he's just exploring. We don't know where he's at in his walk. But yeah, I think part of the message yesterday was the idea that men sometimes get into self-hate, and that is not a good thing, you know, about pounding ourselves about our transgressions and about what we've done and how we've failed and we've not been the leader of the house, et cetera, et cetera. And that's a bad thing. That's, you know, we need to forget what lies behind in that area. But yes, anytime I hear, like, you know, loving yourself, that does sound like a little New Age, a little liberal, a little, you know, you know, when we elevate ourselves, you know, God's going to humble us. I mean, so, but if we lower ourselves, what could be better than the creator and sustainer of the universe exalting us or raising us up, because he's humbled us and we're humbling ourselves. So, yeah, it did, to answer your question, it did. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Just a quick follow-up. So, mm-hmm. In terms of being kind to our brother there, mm-hmm. where would we take that? Because we obviously are not saying we should hate ourselves. We're not saying the opposite.
Right.
So what's the right attitude towards ourselves? Maybe you could elaborate
on loving, that. A loving discussion about, you know, who Christ is and who we are in Christ and who we are outside of Christ and who we, you know, the fact that we are, no, we're maybe the original sin, the idea that they were all under wrath is not, he doesn't know about that concept, you know, it sounds like, that we're all under God, under condemnation until we're in Christ, until we're regenerated. So that, maybe that discussion needs to be had, because our culture is so soaked with the self-love and affirmation, and not to go off, but maybe I will for
a
minute.
Is this the speaker yesterday?
Yeah, no, not Bill Johnson, it was a question.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, Bill was amazing, as he always is.
I was
about
to say, this is...
No, but, I mean, and so in our culture, you know, there's the new people coming into the workplace. I was talking to our accountant the other day, and I said, so, you know, what do you think about your intern? She goes, you know, they're really nice people. They're really gentle people. She said, but
I have to talk to him in such a gentle and affirming way. It's not just about getting the job done. If I don't affirm them 10 different ways, they're offended, and it impedes them getting the job done. And so that hypersensitivity to, you know, not being loved, or you don't love me, or you're not affirming me, wherever I'm at, you know, that's just a cancer that we live in. And I'm concerned about our young people. I'm concerned about our culture and the direction of the nation, et cetera, you know, because we're becoming soft.
Yeah, that's driving a lot of the ministry ideas right now with us as a session, because we see this sort of I was listening to a podcast the other day that was kind of focusing on the breakdown of families, and now you've got sort of state governments and corporations as if they're supposed to fill this father role that everyone has lost, right? Who should be affirming these young people? It's their dads and their moms, right? But now it's the president, it's the government, it's the company should be telling me I'm okay, I'm okay, paying for my stuff and doing all these things and, you know, taking care of me. It's this void that's getting filled in this really perverse way.
So in love, aren't we supposed to bring our kids up in the fear and admonition?
Yeah, right. So that's what we want to make sure that we, as Christians, as covenant families, we reverse this trend, that we show what real family
love
and
is.
Love, and then we see the fruit of that, of the Holy Spirit's work, and then reversing the direction of our culture.
Mm-hmm. And how easy is it to give in as a parent? It's just much easier than.
Well, and that's what we talk about being heavenly minded. I mean, you just. It's easy to just check out.
Yeah.
Say,
that's
this
fine,
is hard. This makes me have to change my thinking or my behavior, and I'd rather not do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it's tough.
Yep, it is tough. Dr. Eddie.
So.
Yes, sir.
I'm not sure he is so off base with the love thing. You know, certainly, the world will think a narcissistic love, but it says that we're to love our neighbors as ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
So that would include that we have a certain attitude about our existence that would be beneficial, that we would be looking to seek what's best for us.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly the Bible defines that, that we would be seeking after the things of God.
Mm-hmm.
So the things that are best for us are keeping God's commands. For this is the love of God, that we would keep his commands, and that we would seek God's will. So these would all be, in a sense, things that we would want our neighbor to do, when we love our neighbor as ourselves, that ideally is we're designed as to be image bearers of God, keepers of God's words, doers of God's word. We would want our neighbor to do that.
Sure.
And that would be, I think, the most loving thing we could do for our neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, giving them more heroin might not be such a loving thing, just because they want it,
but that
we would want to do what's best for them. So I think love has this kind of goal or direction, and that's biblically based.
And God is loving in his commandments because he knows that's what's best for us because he's wired us that way. And maybe I'm a little hypersensitive when I hear the deal self-love, you know what I'm saying? Maybe I'm just kind of, culturally, I'm like, just, whoa, wait a minute.
That would be like the worldly narcissistic.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
You mentioned the keeping of the commandments made me think of the, because there's the four words for love that we get from the Greek, and Pastor Paul has mentioned this before, and I think this is referring to that agape love that we're supposed to have for everybody, and it's the kind of thing where you would not generally break the Ten Commandments against yourself, particularly not murdering yourself or not stealing from yourself.
Right.
That kind of love you would have for yourself needs to be expressed to others. Mm-hmm. It can't have this double standard of, I'm going to treat myself well and you not.
Right.
And I think that's where that's supposed to be. And that has God's commandments in mind as being, in his image. So.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you have to define love, I guess, right, Doctor?
Exactly. That's where the pinpoint is here. Yeah, it's on his terms.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry, somebody else. Bert, do you want to?
Well, he stole my line.
Okay.
he's my doctor, so he'll allow it.
There are particular, just to follow, there's other, the other loves are not necessarily for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Right, brotherly
the
love.
The phileo and the eros.
Yeah, sure,
and
of course.
And the, I always get it wrong. I would say stergos, storge. Those aren't for everyone. They have particular people they're supposed to be aimed at. But yeah, agape is for everyone.
Daniel.
There he is.
You didn't think it wasn't going to happen,
right?
No, I was.
We were wondering why it hadn't happened.
Just really quick, I think it connects to what we're talking about.
Yes.
So the Greek virtue is love of honor, which is obviously, and I think that's what you were getting at earlier. So when you read through Greek lists of virtues, there's not even a concept resembling humility.
Right.
So humility, before Paul takes it up and defines it, you gave I really enjoyed kind of your summary definition of humility there, or humbling oneself. Something like
lowliness of mind about oneself.
About oneself, yeah, especially regarding others. Yeah, so it makes me think of the Pauline injunction, esteem one another better mm-hmm. than yourself, esteem others better than yourself.
Sure.
But so that concept then, from debased, he takes it up into that and makes it a virtue, and makes it a cardinal virtue of Christianity, which that's the upside down kingdom being made right side up. So this is what it means for the Grecians, the Greeks, to lord it over us, right? So they have this love of honor. They seek their own reputation and honor for themselves, and that was celebrated. So I just wanted to encourage you that was a good point.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that, yeah. And that was Stephen Lawson. Actually, I listened to quite a few of his sermons.
That was, that just reminded me, I've been reading through Numbers, I think it's in Numbers, not Exodus, I don't remember now, I guess, but Moses is mentioned as being the most humble person, and this in the face of having constant rebellion against him in the wilderness, 600,000 people.
Grumbling,
yeah. You know, and I never had really a good visualization until I finally, I just finished watching Lord of the Rings for the first time. I know it's been 20 years when I finally got through it. But, you know, they have those scenes where you just see all these orcs just covering this wilderness area. And just imagine, I mean, probably around 600,000. And that's kind of what he's, that's what, imagine Moses being there with this crowd in the middle of nowhere, and they all want to kill him. Mm. And he's the most humble man.
Yeah. Yep.
It's really remarkable.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
I'm in Leviticus now, but Numbers is next.
So. Numbers is a wonderful book. Yeah. I love Numbers.
Yeah.
I love Leviticus too.
I'm struggling through Leviticus. A lot of bloodshed.
We could be.
It's okay. I know that I get the message.
Be holy as he is holy.
I'm trying to read, and that's where I'm trying to read. I'm reading, and I'm going, okay, this is the word of God. I've got to read every word. It's hard, Lord.
We can be Bible buddies if you want to text me. I'll answer.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll do it.
You'll hold me accountable.
I will hold you accountable.
Thank you.
Read Leviticus, Bob. Good morning. Open it up.
100%.
Ruling over Aaron is great to talk to about Leviticus.
Good. That's good. Yes.
Mike.
Yeah, for anyone who's struggling with the book of Numbers, read Ian Duguid's commentary.
D-U-G.
I love the name.
It's I-A-I-N-D-U-G-U-U-I-D, I think.
Oh, yeah, I got that. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll text it to you.
Thank you. Please. By the way, there's a Ligonier conference. I don't know if anybody's interested in Fresno, Lynn and I are going to go up to.
Oh, yeah?
So, yeah, for a couple of days. So,
I am, but not for $450.
I got the early bird discount.
$425 instead of $450.
good question. It's something about God.
God, the Bible.
Sounds like something Sproul or his ministry would say.
Something about God. But, yeah, Stephen Lawson and Robert Godfrey. I really like both those guys. But, you know, that's my deal.
Something about the gospel being essential.
Yeah, something.
Any other questions?
Yes.
Kevin? I didn't say Mark this time.
Kevin's sitting down. Oh, Kevin, there he is.
It's not Mark, it's Kevin.
Okay, Mark. Yeah. Yes, Kevin.
It's not, I don't know if it's a question or just.
Sure.
Helping to think it out. I was thinking about what Dr. Anorga said. with your message or exhortation today, that the Paul's kind of focus about pressing on is for a prize. Mm-hmm. And so that just that idea, almost as like an idea of, like, it's not selfish so much, but he's talking about, like, I'm pressing forward for the prize, and that being a good thing with thinking about loving yourself or whatever. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know he's doing it. He's saying that in the midst of a letter where he's encouraging other people to do the same thing. But mm-hmm. but it, just thinking about what Dr. Anorga said about there being some kind of place for loving ourselves, in that, like Paul is doing that almost. Like he's striving for the prize, for the reward that he's going to get, so to speak.
Yeah, it's hard. It's difficult to parse that out. You know, definitely. There is a reward. That's the Bible talks about it. I mean, ultimately, I think somehow that does help us in times when things are really difficult, you know, here on planet Earth, to go, okay, you know what? I'm called to persevere. I'm trusting in God. I know that there is a prize at the end of this, and it's going to be unbelievable because he's promised that. And that does help us persevere, you know, because if we're just in the midst of this, that's hope in the promises of God. Because if we're just here and just grinding through chaos and anarchy and cells hitting each other, we're you know, evolution of dust or whatever, who cares? Who cares? So, yeah. And, you know, the body's a temple, right? I mean, the body is a temple. We're to take care of the body. So there is self-love there, yes. But what love? What is love? Again, defining it, you know, like in 1 Corinthians.
Yeah. Yeah, and that difficulty of having one word in our language meaning so many different things.
Yeah. Yes.
You know, like I love vanilla ice cream. You know, yes. I love my wife. I love, you know, love football. It's like hard to.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're all different.
Yes, they are.
Yeah.
Yes.
I don't love football, but.
Daniel, go ahead. Keep them coming, bro.
Sorry. I heard an again. That was me apologizing.
Never apologize.
So the Bible is very clear that we're to love the image and likeness of mm-hmm. God mm-hmm. in all creatures.
Right.
So would it not be absurd to fail to love the image and likeness of God in ourselves?
Yeah, 100%. Yes. Yeah. I guess maybe the challenge is we don't, if we're seeing through a glass darkly, and we have, and there were the noetic effects of the fall, then it's hard to see the image of God, you know. It's there, but the more, I guess, we're sanctified, the more we're able to see it, and the more we're able to truly love ourselves and love our neighbor.
Yeah, and the proverb is apropos about all those who hate wisdom love death.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that death includes your own.
Yes.
If you don't love God, you're not going to like what he created, including yourself. You're not going to like how you were created.
Yep.
You're going to want to change that or destroy it.
Yep.
And you'll want to see others be destroyed as well. You know, if your father is the father of all lies, you'll want other people to have him as their father. And that just sort of breeds this chain of death towards yourself and towards others.
Exactly.
So,
yeah, it's momentum. And I know, I mean, I've had a conversation with a brother this week that just struggling mightily with self-hate, you know, and just it's like, wow, you know, it's a problem. I'm a guy. I'm not a woman. I don't know. Women have their own struggles for sure. But with guys, I think there's a lot of self-hate, you know, and especially in this one particular friend. And just like it's really difficult, you know. God doesn't love me. You know, I feel this self-hatred. God doesn't love me.
But see, that is not, right? That's I don't want to say insincere, but there's, and like how we have in our membership vows, we're supposed to abhor mm-hmm. ourselves,
sure.
right?
Sure.
But when you hear words like that, God doesn't love me, mm-hmm. right? And when we come here, we confess our sins.
I don't feel like God loves me. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's not a factual statement. Maybe it's, I don't feel like God loves me.
But then you're making the conclusion still.
sure. that he doesn't love me because sure. I don't feel it. When we confess our sins up here and mm-hmm. then the elder pronounces,
yeah.
the scriptures say right. God has forgiven you.
Mm-hmm.
If you're kind of insisting on denying that,
yes.
right? Because mm-hmm. you're saying God doesn't love me, then you're denying that.
Sure.
Right. Then that's different right. from abhorring ourselves because of our sin.
Of course.
You know, and we welcome, if that's the case, then we really welcome that forgiveness. We welcome that,
sure.
that love. And it's not, he's not partial. He's not
right.
singling you out to be different. Well, you're right. the one guy I don't forgive.
Of course.
Right? So yeah. of all that he's chosen, he's going to be the same.
Right. Them,
forgiving. So there's a bit of a...
contradiction
yeah.
there.
Yeah, yeah, there is.
Yeah.
It's not he's true not, humility in right. the sense that he's 100%. Welcoming God
right.
to save him.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's other, yeah, and I don't know, other, I haven't struggled with that. I've struggled with other stuff, you know, but never with really intense self-hate, but that's got to be painful, you know.
Uh-huh, yeah.
It's, you know, so anyway.
It's a trap for sure.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Thank you. Okay, we get a professional opinion.
Yeah, now we're in trouble.
No, thank you.
Now, so, everything we said is
please.
Wrong.
I'm all ears. Go.
Well, the Lord says the truth will set you free, right? And so loving ourselves can mean wanting to be free, mm-hmm. you know, and wanting to hang on to the truth. And if we entertain these thoughts like, mm-hmm. God doesn't love me, or I'm not good enough, or any of those false kind of thoughts, mm-hmm. if we're a true believer and we really believe that we've been forgiven, mm-hmm. then we open the door to this lie. Mm-hmm. And then if we're caught in that lie, then it gives us license to sin.
Yeah,
right? Yeah, sure.
It does.
It opens the door
sure.
that I'm already a loser. I'm yeah, already yeah, a failure. Sure. God doesn't love me.
Sure.
So, you know, and here the enemy is telling you
of
that.
Course, of course.
You might as well do it. You're a loser anyways. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, then you feel like crap. And then you feel like, oh, and then you shame yourself. So loving yourself is really keeping that in check.
So shame is the big word there.
Yes. You know. If you shame yourself, you're not loving yourself,
yeah.
right? You're
yeah.
you're opening the door for the enemy's mm-hmm. wrath to come mm-hmm. upon you. So mm-hmm. it's your doing. Mm-hmm. That's not God's doing.
Mm-hmm.
So loving yourself is really standing in the truth
mm-hmm.
and trusting God to say the truth about who you are.
Mm-hmm.
I believe I am who God says I am,
mm-hmm.
not who I feel like
mm-hmm.
I am or who
sure.
the enemy says I am, but I believe I am who God says I am. I'm
mm-hmm.
forgiven, I'm accepted, I'm,
mm-hmm.
you know, I'm his daughter. He'll never snatch me. I'll never be snatched from his hands.
Mm.
And so I think that loving yourself is really grasping on to the truth and fighting for that truth.
Mm.
And we have to do that on a daily basis. And that's the fighting the good fight.
Mm-hmm.
And that's doing it in fear and trembling.
Yeah. Yeah. No, thank you for that. I'm gonna watch the video of this. I'm gonna write down everything you just said.
Well, and you notice what she pointed out there, the what the license that
mm-hmm.
results
yeah.
from this
yeah.
is that I get to go sin
yeah.
because of whatever
yeah.
the reason was. And
yeah.
that was kind of there's a difference in the resolve there.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if I really welcome God's forgiveness, then my behavior has to change now.
Go
and sin no more. But if I have an excuse such
yeah,
as
of course.
I don't feel this or whatever,
yeah.
then the
mm-hmm.
license to sin I get to keep.
Yes,
100%. And that becomes that really is underneath it all. That's really the motivation.
It does, I mean, yeah. I kind of the pieces are coming together now.
Yeah.
You know, when you talk about that and trying to understand.
I mean, I don't know.
No, it's
personally,
it's,
but this
no,
is
no, it's it, that. Yeah, and that ties into other. Go ahead.
And that's the narcissistic love.
Sure.
See,
yeah.
If you open the door to that, it's really a manipulation.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
You
sure. Right.
Want that easy route.
Exactly.
You really want to call yourself a loser so that you can continue doing
right.
loser things. It's easy. It's easy. You don't have to do the work.
Yeah.
Continuous fight. You know, why get up in the morning? Why do this? Why do that? Why? Because we're called to do that. Because we have to do what's hard. We have
mm-hmm.
to challenge ourselves and do what's right. And if we give in to that,
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like believing Satan's lies only because we want to, mm-hmm. you know, self-gratify.
Yeah, and there's...
Immediate gratification. Yeah.
Mm-hmm, yeah, so the, and, you know, a lot of this has to do with, you know, addiction, addictive personalities, and kind of having that little one little part of your being where you can go, you know what, if I really feel bad, there's a bottle up in the corner up there that I can always go there. And I just as long as I know it's there, and I can, you know, it gives me comfort. And then if I really feel bad, because they don't feel like, they don't have the confidence that they can sustain the onslaught without it. Without that hope, just on their own, just on God's grace, that God will carry them through that. Yeah, it's hard stuff, you know, hard stuff. Yeah.
Yes. Completely unrelated question.
Would you mind going to the microphone so that we could?
But I just want to make sure that someone else had like something that was pertinent to that before I
came. We can be yanked around. Can we be
yanked
around? So I was wondering, Bob, if you could answer this or tell me how you would answer this question. So if somebody who was an unbeliever had, we'll say, a little bit of knowledge about Christianity, you know, mm-hmm. like enough where you can have a conversation with somebody, but they don't mm-hmm. know all the ins and outs stuff, and who is of a mindset who actually wants to learn and wants to hear your answer. Right. If somebody asks you to explain the doctrine of predestination, how would you respond to somebody like that? Because I've been asked that, so I'm getting your...
I would get out the Westminster Confession of Faith and read it. No, I mean, yeah. I mean, great question. Thanks for putting me on the spot, Diana.
You're welcome.
That. Yeah. So God has ordained everything that comes to pass. He's sovereign. He's over all things. He's omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. He's infinite. All goodness, truth, knowledge, beauty. He's a sovereign Lord, and he has predestined that everything that comes to pass will come to pass. And he is, I hate to use the word control, it's an orchestration maybe you would use in control of. I know control is a really kind of triggering word these days, but he orchestrates everything together in our lives for us to work his will in our lives. And orchestration through primary causes and secondary causes. But he's infinite, sovereign, that's your starting point. And he predestines everything that comes to pass and will do so until eternity. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Is that a good, I don't know if that's a satisfactory. You know, R.C. Sproul, I'm sure, has a good thing on that. Or any Calvin or, what's that? Yeah, that's a good one, yes.
The thing is, like, I know all that.
Right.
And I could say all that.
Right.
Like, how to have that conversation. So,
and yeah. maybe it's got to be personal. Maybe it's got to be like, hey, you know, so what's going on in your life? Tell me, you know, we can talk in theological terms a lot of times, you know, but when it becomes personal and there's an opening for us to get a window into their soul and what they're really, if they really have a desire to learn and then kind of somehow enter into that on a personal level, you know? I don't know if that makes any sense, but versus, you know, theology and staying up here versus in the heart.
Or like asking what's making you ask that question.
Yeah, yeah, that's a great question. Yeah, ask a question, yeah, that's great.
Yeah,
there you go.
That's a good thing, but I was also thinking you could, you know, people understand actually what mm-hmm. they are asking you already because I mean, you could say, well, he wouldn't be God if he wasn't godding, to use it as a verb, right? And people use this term loosely to say, oh, the gods of this or the gods of that. People mm-hmm. kind of know what you're saying when they say that this is the person orchestrating and ordaining everything. They mm-hmm. they know that. So when you say predestined, it's really just God is who he is. And he's God of mm-hmm. everything. Mm-hmm. And so he gods things because mm-hmm. he's God.
That defines him.
That is him, yeah.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Eddie, please.
Two thoughts to add to that.
Yes.
You know, there's also kind of the emotional side of that, and that's in Romans 10, which is assurance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that in, you know, if in fact God is sovereign over our creation and went so far as to send his son,
we can have the assurance that nothing will separate us from the love of God. And if there was some things that were out of God's control, then something could step in there and get in the way. Mm-hmm. But apparently it can't happen that way.
Right.
The other thing, other way to, I mean, when Jesus talks to Peter and says, are you now going to leave too with everybody else? And he says, well, only you have the words of eternal life. So, well, what does the world have to offer us with regards to this whole issue of predestination?
Sure.
What the world has to offer us is, well, you're just a product of your past experiences and your upbringing and your genetics. And there's this idea of strict determinism in that. So really, you know, we're locked in. We're locked in to this thing where we really don't have, quote unquote, free will. You know, that whatever we choose or decide is really a product of our previous experience and our genetics and all these other things. Mm-hmm. So that's the idea of strict determinism. It's kind of like you can't really get away from it. Mm-hmm. You know, the world doesn't offer you something better. Mm-hmm. And then finally, I guess there's three points. You know, Lena brought up that it's the truth that sets us free. Mm-hmm. And that freedom comes from God giving us his word and his spirit so that we're not tied by our fleshly limitations. Mm-hmm. You know, we're no longer a slave to our fleshly desires, our fleshly limitations, our limited knowledge, our worldly, you know, enterprises, you know, that we have now a different point of view from which we can make true and free decisions. So I would maybe think about going on in those directions.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Oh,
go ahead,
Eric.
Please.
You said more than once that the Apostle Paul is the greatest Christian that ever lived. So would it be proper for us to conclude that in glory he will be occupying one of those seats of honor at either Jesus' left or right?
That's a great question. First of all, I've heard that from a couple of people I listened to that I thought were reliable sources, and I'd be hard pressed to find another Christian equal to the Apostle Paul. I do think he was the greatest Christian that ever lived, and we can have a discussion about that. But based on that, that's a good question. I haven't really thought about that. That's a good question. Seats of honor. I mean, I'm not going to answer that because I put my foot in my mouth. How's that for an honest
answer? We were told in Scripture not to debate that, right? I mean, that's why they were rebuked for being like, who gets to sit at your right and left?
Yeah. Yeah. So.
I mean.
No, you're right. No, you're right. You're absolutely right.
So.
Yeah. I mean, good question. I haven't. But I mean, do you think that the Apostle Paul was the greatest Christian that ever lived? What do you think?
I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of people that have lived in a life that have been Christians, so I don't have that access to that.
Well, yeah, okay, there you go. Yeah, I was waiting for that, Daniel. But Christian means little
Christ.
Little Christ. Yeah, and Christian means a follower of Christ. So was he following himself? You know, it was Jesus and everybody else. So.
But like we talk about election, what Calvin does, and this may help, what mm-hmm. really helped me with election is mm-hmm. the human nature of Jesus being elect.
Daniel, you need to use the mic.
And him being the elect one.
One thing to think about.
Mm-hmm.
I was, you know, kind of doing the whole Jesus is the answer earlier over there when I was unmiked. But so there's this interesting question about what do we do with the Christianity of Christ? Can Christ be a Christian? Can he mm-hmm. believe in himself? All that kind of stuff. But right. I want to put a quick plug in for John Calvin because he never gets enough good press here, mm-hmm. which is that he talks about election in the context of Jesus Christ being the elect one. Mm. And that Jesus Christ's human nature was elected mm. and predestined and foreordained from mm-hmm. the foundation of the earth mm-hmm. to be united mm-hmm. in one person with the second person of the Trinity. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is something that a lot of people who are hostile to predestinarianism, predestination, they haven't heard that. And because for me, it was like, whoa, that's a different angle. So I just found that to be ministerial to me. Thanks.
And Kevin, right? Kevin? Just answer.
Derek.
Jeez. Forgive me, Derek. I think that part of the idea, too, is that, okay, we have the recorded history of the Apostle Paul, his life, his what he did. I mean, we have a lot of information about him. And so if he is the chief of sinners and he sees himself, you know, what about us? I mean, that's kind of, we can debate whether he was the greatest Christian ever lived. I mean, authoritatively, do I know that? No, but I would argue that point. I think I would have a good argument. But however, the point is that if he sees himself, humbles himself, what about us? You know. And then secondly, Stephen Lawson was talking about in one of his lectures about, I think it's Philippians 2:16-17, about examples that we follow, that we have. And, you know, we all need examples. I mean, I look up to Pastor Paul. You know, I do. He's a great example of a Christian man, you know. I look up to historical figures. We can read biographies. They're a great resource of inspiration for us and model and there's a pattern that we should try to follow in our lives. And then we're to take, hopefully, whatever God is working in us, and that should be in a baton passed down to, we should be examples, hopefully, for other people, God willing, you know. So, point being that as an example and as a comparison, I think the Apostle Paul is, you know, hard to match up to. Yes? No, not another difficult. No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
So since we're on the what-ifing kind of topic here.
Oh, this is dangerous.
It is.
So the Apostle Paul was not one of the 12 original apostles. Uh-huh. He was an apostle lately born.
Right.
Judas was disqualified, and Matthias was elected to take his place.
Yes.
That leaves us with a problem, because there are 12 thrones in heaven, and there are 13 apostles, if you count Apostle Paul. Who do you think might be the one sitting on the 12th throne, Matthias or Paul?
You know what? I appreciate
maybe,
that.
Maybe it's like a heavenly musical chairs that wants the music.
Sure. I appreciate that question, and I would have to think about that. I'm not equipped to answer that, honestly, and it's a great what-if question.
I think you're the greatest Christian soap opera star that ever lived.
Did you have to
say
that?
Okay? Is that okay to say that?
Did you really have to say that?
I did have to say that. It was like gnawing
at me. I bet there are other Christians out there that were much greater than me. Trust me.
I thought that there were 24 thrones. Am I?
Thrones, 24 elders.
24 elders around it, and then there was 12. Okay. Yes, you're right. So there are 12 gates and 12. Yeah, that's a tough question. Yeah.
Well done, Diana. If I do the math, 12 doesn't equal 13. That's a problem. Yeah.
Not even in heaven.
That's right. Thank you, Diana.
Yeah, I think it's important that we don't get into the speculation and sort of up, we don't want to venerate saints and that sort of thing. So I just kind of don't want to go down that road at all.
Yeah.
You know, we're all in Christ and we are all with him after death in paradise, from the thief on the cross to Paul.
Right.
So,
and we can look at the other Christians as examples to inspire us.
Absolutely, sure. In all the different ways. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
Daniel, and then maybe.
What a cop out.
Revelation 4:4.
Yes.
And round about the throne were 24 seats, and upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold.
All right.
24 seats.
Thank you.
Where does it say from the 12 apostles?
I have to look it up.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Are y'all hungry?
Yeah.
Right. Well, let's.
Well, thank you.
Thank
for
you
joining us.
Appreciate the.
Thank you for.
Appreciate the questions.
Yeah.
The insightful questions always.